So whose art matters? Indigenous art in the age of reconciliation. I want to start with a quick test and show of hands. How many of you in the room are familiar with the Group of Seven? Okay, as expected. How many of you know of the Indian Group of Seven who collectively came together as a professional National Indian Arts Incorporation in 1973? Thank you. So Sabio Agwegu, Orinianus Rijas, Kanyakehaga, Dananganawage, Nidawagano, I respectfully recognize I am a guest in beautiful unceded Tsleil-Waututh territory. I want to thank Stephen Foster, Ashok Mathur, and Toby Lawrence for the invitation to deliver one of the keynotes for the UBC Summer Indigenous Art Intensive. I don't know if there was a bio that was circulated, or I checked.
There's one on that one.
Okay. So I don't need to do that. You could Google it or read it. So today's presentation is called From Bits and Pieces Accumulated Over Recent Years from Ideas I Had Previously Presented and Exists as a Work in Progress that somehow remains relevant to me, that I can consistently rewrite, rethink, and share. So I'm constantly returning to these ideas that I will present because they're critical to my work and engagement with the field of criticism and curatorial practice and beyond. So Indigenous studies, art history, visual culture. Because comprehensive Indigenous art histories are still scattered in boxes, brochures, handouts, notebooks, catalogs, journals, ephemera, websites, video, Facebook posts, events, etc., that have yet to be gathered succinctly. This flurry of knowledge or discourse resembles the distinctiveness of our communities, reserves, and nations strewn across our land. It is mapped, but not evidently navigated in the most tangible way. The knowledge we create to engage as well as to disrupt the art historical canon has now become a right resource in the age of reconciliation. The arguments, dialogue, criticism produced 30 years ago, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and I'm engaging within my own participation and experience in this time frame, are getting spun in heavy rotation now, but the playlist is limited. The labor to collect, locate, maintain, and draw from this amassed inquiry has been a personal and community-driven journey, and I compiled a wholesome but not comprehensive bibliography for the Aboriginal Curatorial Collective website. I think it's still there, but that needs a lot of work to be updated. And I have witnessed Indigenous art slowly seep into art and education institutions. So I'm at OCAD, we have a program called Indigenous Visual Culture that's in its fifth year. We had our first graduate this year. So slowly looking at how change is coming into these institutions, because art has been effective quite substantially from all the policies that have been in place that have impacted us over the last 150 years and beyond. So recently, I was drawn to New Generation Photography Award winner Merrill McMaster's piece, Time's Gravity, for my lecture I gave in June called How Many Times Do I Have to Tell You at Ryerson Image Center, which was programmed alongside Shelley Nero's Scotiabank Prize exhibition. Because this work embodies the weight of knowledge many of us carry, I thought it would be a good way to show the burden of information that we carry with us every day. We try to unpack it at night. I wake up in the middle of the night with that feeling on my shoulders that knowledge needs to be shared. So this burden of information, which I call it, is a contentious site in advancing Indigenous visual culture, given Indians of North America are one of the most studied, collected, and written about cultures in the world. As Indigenous curators, writers, critics, and artists, we are constantly juggling how much preliminary information is necessary without reducing significant ideologies, philosophies, epistemologies, cosmologies as a superficial footnote specifically for the uninformed. And one of the things that I've done for a number of years now is I refuse to footnote Gerald Visner's survivance theory. A lot of times people say, this needs a footnote, and I say, no, it doesn't. You need to know what it is. Tuscarora artist and scholar Jolene Ricard wrote in the catalog for my exhibition, Counting Coup, quote, Herein lies an important conceptual dilemma for ongoing construction of contemporary indigenous experience. Is it good enough for artists and curators to generally have sense about indigenous histories and philosophies, or do we need to be authorities on every detail? How much of the past do we need to understand to imagine a future? End of quote. So this question weighs our scholarship down to some extent, whether it's curatorial criticism or arts-based practice, because you need to ask, why do you still not know much about us? So well over 2 years ago in the halls of OCAD University, I walked by a poster announcing a call for submissions on the subject of whose art counts. It made me stop, I paused, and returned to the photocopy poster for a closer look. Upon reading it, I quickly tore it off the wall, because I thought it was quite clever, which I kept clearly for research, archival purposes, and educational purposes. It piqued my interest, and I was pleased to see the student initiative and the degree of thoughtfulness it addressed. It spoke specifically to an absence within the art historical canon, which continues to be positioned and universally taught from a Euro-Western purview that is held up to the highest standards and attitudes in education, art institutions, and society at large. But more specifically, it addressed the issues I have navigated and worked very hard to counter through my professional career and practice as an artist, curator, and educator, which led me to ask the question more specifically, whose art matters? And this was in reference to my neighbor at OCAD, which is the Art Gallery of Ontario, and that's the slogan that they used to promote their space. So as it remains critical, given the ongoing circumstances we face in a society of counterfeit culture relying on colonial myth-making, and I quote Roland Barthes' proposition, myth is stolen. Myth hides nothing, its function is to distort and not to make disappear. And this is current, we can see this currently at play over and over again with enraged situations such as what has been presented in the last week or two with Ex Machina Robert Lepage's issue to Slave in the Kannada productions, whether the proactive conflicts of extraction or taking and ethics have evolved beyond land and resources are now drawing upon our ideas, aesthetics, bodies, and lived experiences without us. It is crucial that we, the Indigenous art community with allies and supporters, take up a position to be present with it even more aggressively within scholarship, research, exhibitions, creative practice, to feed a public discourse since our foothold in the institutions have become stronger. It is work that generations have been tirelessly doing only to get handed down to the next generation in bits and pieces and carried forward both meticulously and haphazardly. We are situated in a moment of re, the preposition to bring attention to, emphasize, concerning, and it is no wonder reconciliation, revitalization, reactivation, regeneration, relearn, retell, recover, and we can add on to this list over and over, but it brings emphasis and is compelling us to insert, not reinsert, ourselves to the center. It is no wonder interventions such as Daniel Heath Justice's new book, Why Indigenous Literature Matter, Jesse Wente and Lisa Jackson's conversation on CBC insisting why Indigenous film matters, and just today, Joseph Boyden resurrected in the Globe and Mail in a new issue that we'll be learning about more and more. And the community support for the letter to Robert Lepage are most recent examples emphasizing why we must tell our own stories, which was also the case in point that guided the formation of the Aboriginal Curatorial Collective well over 12 years ago, SCANA, the Society of Canadian Artists of Native Ancestry, 30 years ago, the Indian Group of Seven, 50 years ago. These analysis and collective formations invite us to assess and consider any transformation or transformations taking place or not. So at the invitation of OCAD student Emily Norrie, I presented a short iteration of this research called Whose Art Matters for her event, Whose Art Counts, that I talked about the poster, on January 11, 2017, alongside a panel focusing on an underrepresented community of artists and students. So I have an Instagram post, and I don't know how to find that image, but it's there somewhere. So June 7, 2016, Instagram post. On June 7, 2016, I popped into the AGO gift shop at lunch to browse for a gift. A quick study revealed that Kent Monkman was the only Indigenous artist amongst 18 full bookshelves of Canadian contemporary artists, A to Z monographs, surveys, Tashin, photography, lifestyle, and art history books. There was also a half table display with some Native books, not very significant, one of the neat artsy, postcard, and a magnet. No Indigenous representation in jewelry displays or in the Made in Canada curated knickknacks, Woo AGO. Furthermore, to be fair, a catalog of Northwest Coast art, Northwest Coast mass-produced scarves, a shawl, totem stackable ceramic mugs and oven mitts, and an Inuit art calendar and catalog were also placed upon this small table. And then, so to update you, this has been significantly resolved since fall 2017. However, an Indigenous absence was significant and at the same time reduced within the commercial space that complemented a visitor's gallery experience within an institution that employs the campaign, Art Matters, and Art Makes Me Happy. Didn't make me happy that day. So while the AGO, like many mainstream museums and galleries, have been making amends, and Wanda Nanabush was named Curator of Indigenous Art in the fall of 2017, and the AGO has recently dedicated and installed nearly one-third of the AGO with Indigenous art, others are catching up and recognizing the contributions and impact of Indigenous art within their scope and mandate that supported and have been obstacles to Indigenous artists, curators, that Indigenous artists and curators face to have their work acquired and programmed not too long ago. And not too long ago is like a minute ago, to some extent. Whose art matters continues to be a long-lasting question that we still need to ask. We can't let it rest. The question extends beyond Indigenous art as a means to consider a more wholesome recognition of diversity, as well as a proactive way to address equity within a global arts framework, where cultures, locality, regionalism, diaspora are taking back space. Two works that probe the question whose art matters and answer simultaneously are Carl Beam's Bury the Ruler series and Shelley Nero's The Shirt. Both works have left a significant impression on my practice and continue to influence my scholarship because they speak of truth, advanced decolonial strategies, and at the same time are forms of resistance. From my exhibition essay for Counting Coup, I wrote, quote, by inserting and acknowledging an Indigenous presence within a colonial narrative, history becomes more relevant, true, and can achieve balance across intellectual, political, social, historical, and cultural landscapes. Acts of declaration challenge and disrupt the dominant grip of a commonly accepted yet prejudiced Western American-Canadian history. Carl Beam diligently challenged the colonial project through his critical body of work, and you can see the Columbus Suite as an example, as well as his works Bury the Ruler and Rulers, symbolically enact a traditional sense of balance rather than imperialistic dominance. For Beam, quote, the ruler, a Western tool for measurement, acts as a metaphor of power, control, and supremacy. Through the bold symbolic gesture of burying the ruler, Beam collapses forms of power based on dominance, clearing the way for others to be acknowledged by and to participate in a realistic post-colonial discourse. Beam's work is a critical call to action that is quite simple, yet still challenging to attain. The Shirt, on the other hand, by Shelley Nero, exposes the violence inflicted upon Indigenous people in our land. In the essay Matriarchal Matters, I wrote, quote, in the photographic series and video, Nero excavates the collective memory of more than 500 Indigenous nations. Her map unfolds, exposing the landscape identified as Turtle Island, where she pinpoints the everlasting beating hearts of these distinct and diverse communities. Nero locates the spirit of Indigenous sovereignty within each nation's vitality and endurance, opposing neocolonialism and all of its complications and implications. As she observes the enormous shift in territorial borders and boundaries due to colonization, Nero heeds a collective voice that declares, this land is ours. The incantatory ancestral voice is loud and clear, but only for those who listen. It moves across the land, making noises through encounters with forms of displacement and destruction. It hushes to silence, overwhelmed by development and progress. From a community level to a national scope, many have tried to make the collective voice heard. The shirt offers a brutal, truthful message that speaks to a history uncovering invasion and settler relationships that indigenous people have experienced worldwide. The shirt is a souvenir, a memory, a burden, and a legacy that is worn, well worn by many. And I checked today, if you could watch the video, it's on YouTube. You just type in Shell Nero on the shirt. Nero and Beam's subtle and provocative works and persistent will to respond to the question, whose art matters directly, and claim a critical space or platform for indigenous artists to advance agency and narrative within the mainstream of contemporary art practice that is not Western. Beam situated his work to expose the disparities, blemishes, and realities of our world, and he did it in a manner that was triumphant and hopeful, ever conscious of the moral fiber of humanity. His themes were local and global, aimed at both old and new world sensibilities to unravel the complex mechanism of colonialism, acknowledging it as a process of conquest and discovery, but framing it from an affirmative position of survivance, which took into account resilience, adaptability, and tradition. His expression of resistance to imperialism, dominance, and oppression takes the shape of a counter-discourse that is proactive, negotiable, and vigorously indigenous. Nero's work, in parallel to Beam's disposition, and focuses on a matrilineal feminist lens to her narrative strategies. The reality of inclusion of indigenous practices within the mainstream is still far from perfect and requires a lot of attention at every level. By moving forward contemporaneously, an active sense of presence over absence is critical to maneuver and expand our position from the margins on one hand to the center on the other. The shift is not only specific to art, but rather an act to disrupt and challenge the commonly accepted privileged narrative of colonial histories. The limitations of a manufactured Canadian identity and stubborn prejudices embedded in history, and in this case, art history. So how did we get here? And why did indigenous art matter? The colonial project denied indigenous expression from flourishing through its mechanism of cultural genocide, supported through policies we should all be familiar with by now. However, national policy establishing a Canadian identity was significant to negating indigenous art practices. In 1951, the Royal Commission on the National Development in the Arts, Letters, and Sciences, also known as the Massey Commission, released a report which eventually led to the formation of Canada Council for the Arts. The study to examine Canada's cultural assets and recognize Canada's rich cultural history was deeply embedded in European culture and supported imported European-based art forms such as the Beaux-Arts, ballet, classical music, theater, and literature. That same year, 1951, the Indian Act, the Canadian Act of Parliament legislated in 1876, was amended to allow certain cultural expressions that were prohibited since 1884's cultural ban. This prohibition, along with the colonial experiments supporting cultural genocide through such measures as residential school enfranchisement, appropriation, forced removal, displacement, the pass system, colonization road, together all of these national violence strategies paved the path towards extinction, erasure of indigenous people through the colonial project that severed access to culture, customary traditions, artistic practice, language, land, and ceremony. The Massey Commission included a section called Indian Arts and Crafts, which reported the following, quote, "This unsatisfactory state of affairs has led some to believe that since the death of true Indian arts is inevitable, Indians should not be encouraged to prolong the existence of arts, which at best must be artificial and at worst are degenerate. The the impact of the white man with his more advanced civilization and his infinitely superior techniques resulted in the gradual destruction of the Indian way of life. The Indian arts thus survive only as ghosts or shadows of a dead society. They can never, it is said, regain real form or substance. Indians with creative talent should therefore develop it as other Canadians do, and should receive every encouragement for this purpose, but Indian art as such cannot be revived. This misconstrued statement dismissed, rejected, and discounted any development of Indigenous art from the art system and resources the Commission would go on to support the Canada Council, relegating Indigenous art to the fields of science, positioned primarily within anthropology and ethnography, globally, and as it was categorized and collected for decades and decades. As a result, celebrated artist Daphne Objic steadfastly said, the doors weren't open to us. In a paper I have recently reconstructed for the Ricard Journal titled Presence and Absence, Redux Indian Art in the 1990s, which I presented at a colloquium way back in 2001 on postcolonialism, I wrote and rewrote to such a history. So you have to think about this as looking at the 90s. In the context of Indian art in Canada, red is a signifier of absence. A decade and a half later, 15 years, now 16 years, there is still an urgency to critically analyze the theoretical questions of globalization and post-colonialism to measure the long-standing framework of prejudice and exclusion against the momentum of significant presence of Indigenous influences across a shifting global art and cultural discourse. In light of the 150th anniversary of Canada's Confederation and framed through an underlying national objective of reconciliation, it is imperative to take another look back at where we have been as the past knowingly informs the future. The reiteration and recollection of Indigenous contributions largely identifies how the 90s was a pivotal decade for the advancement and positioning of Indigenous art into this millennium, the 21st century, which appeals to the need to compensate our prior absence by foregrounding Indigenous histories and recentering indigeneity. In the 90s, there were no intentions for a national apology nor a national framework for truth and reconciliation sanctioned. Yet, the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples was realized, a national art policy assessment completed, and Indigenization was a self-determined form of resistance and resurgence that was activated by us, not institutions or government. It was a decade that situated Indigenous art and culture in the context of arrival, a continuum driven from the blueprint map decades earlier by the groundbreaking and strategic revolutionary efforts of the Indians of Canada Pavilion at Montreal's Expo 67 to legitimize our creative economies and agency across the institution of art and culture on the world stage. The indications of that arrival abounded during the 90s when our many voices, when silence excluded strength as well as diversity. Fine examples of art in all disciplines were created and exhibited for the public to gain a better understanding and appreciation of our communities, our cultures, and our struggles. The arts strengthened our identity as well as Canada's. However, we were still marginalized as others. Not Western, not Canadian, not American, simply not. And therefore not comprehensible, or not up to standard, not aesthetically pleasing, or valued within art's rigid attitudes and arrogance. By re-examining the 1990s in cultural, economic, and political terms, we see that much of our relationship with the nation state and thus with major institutions was still dominated by colonial methods of Western art and culture systems. Our practice was constantly being measured across levels of authenticity, ethnography, and art theory, making the odds against us to be successful to some extent. The institutions struggled to see our reality and placed us in either a museum context of the past or a contemporary situation as the other in the present. They were unsuccessful in their ability to declassify us to one specific movement or period. Their linear approach did not allow them to see how we see. Our future contained both the past and the present, built from traditional knowledge that has foresight to address our forthcomings. The issue of representation and the absence of our art from mainstream institutions was one of the constant debate amongst Indigenous artists and curators. non-Indigenous curators and critics sometimes had a hesitancy to work with Indigenous artists due to the lack of understanding of our culture because we challenged the ethics and values of colonization and how they evaluated our practice. Questions they raised again and again include, how does it fit in and where do you put it? We constantly asked ourselves, did we even want to submit to their judgment? Often we were passed over to the anthropologists or ethnographers who became the new gatekeepers of our advancement as contemporary practitioners. In this ethnographic context, works considered were commonly measured by their authenticity, narrative, and traditional nature, second place to aesthetic and artistic value. SCANA, the Society of Canadian Artists of Native Ancestry, a lobby and advocacy group founded in 1978, had addressed these issues of presence, absence, the placement, and representation of Indigenous art in Canada, and did so into the mid-1990s. Its members participated as advisors and supporters for various exhibitions, Beyond History, Indigena, and critiqued the National Gallery for its lack of Indigenous representation in its collection and programming. SCANA's presence and sustained lobbying efforts became recognized as a national voice for Indigenous art in Canada and was supported by the Assembly of First Nations and financially through the Indian Arts Centre. Artists had to fight for a place. Their efforts granted to some effect, seeing Carl Beam's The North American Iceberg to become the first work of contemporary art by an Indigenous artist and recognized as such, to be acquired by the National Gallery of Canada in 1986. Other artists such as Robert Markle and Rita Latondre entered under the radar as Canadian artists. Land, Spirit, and Power in 1992 would be the first major exhibition at the National Gallery of Canada of Indigenous contemporary art. This exhibition claimed that it put aside Western parameters of art to accept the more multivocal expression of art, marking an important step towards the openness of spirit that we hope will characterize the next 125 years. So it was the National Gallery's 125th celebration of their existence. Unfortunately, we felt the absence of our presence within Canada's major art institution, with no Indigenous curators or representation, exhibitions, and substantial programming throughout the rest of that decade. Since Morisseau in 2006, Bojig in 2007, Jiangui in 2016, Beam and Sakahan in 2014, and the recent rehang of its galleries have taken up a significant space and attention. So attitudes did change at that level. In contemplating the celebratory actions and cultural currency Canada 150 intended to present or represent, it has been a long haul to find footing in the art world since we were lesser than, too political, essentialized, and not authentic enough. Which seems to be the reverse today. You need to be political. You need to be authentic. So it's you know, catch-22s. Our established presence catapulted us into a national as well as an international realm that recognized our contributions to contemporary artistic development and practice. Exhibitions of new works, retrospective, and further experimentation in the arts strengthen our creative output with an emphasis on nationhood, community, and home becoming stronger than ever, and advocating for our place in institutions and our history was rising. We continue to produce work, to write, and to curate at a rate we never had before, yet we still remain absent from text and educational art history courses that discuss the larger picture of art history, which we still feel in 2018. It was felt that in order to find our place within the global picture, we must tell and retell, write and rewrite our own histories. Art's attitude has shifted to some extent, has created a social framework for Western art education to be challenged with the question we started with, whose art counts and whose art matters. In the age of reconciliation, Canada has now positioned it, and shockingly has enormously failed Indigenous people recently with the Colton Gouchee and Tina Fontaine verdicts. We have all been tasked with addressing the four calls to action. In the late fall of 2015, the student union at OCAD University put a call for participation for an event focusing on social justice to be framed around art and design practice that would consider our civic responsibilities. As a means to activate the calls, I propose to curate a public reading of the TRC's calls to action framed as a four-hour endurance performance to be enacted through multiple voices to inform the OCAD University community and beyond, and participants of the event Signal Boost Art Designs Social Justice Exchange of the multitude of recommendations brought forth. The public reading was intended to shift the burden and advance the process of Canadian reconciliation. It was critical the calls to action needed to be heard out loud. By amplifying the message repeatedly, the impact of the residential school legacy would be revealed through a community forum that invites everyone to embrace the findings for positive change. The event I curated was titled Well Read, Activating the TRC's Call to Action, with the aim to introduce reconciliation as a shared journey that acknowledges truth is being told as well as heard. The emphasis was to make known that as a society, our responsibility for reconciliation is to first recognize, believe, and accept that there have been injustices and understand the truths that require restoration. And in order to successfully restore our collective spirit, we must bring our minds and hearts together. I positioned the well-read event around the message embedded in the Ohanda Gariwadekwa, the opening Thanksgiving address recited at gatherings, to consolidate all of our thoughts by reminding us that we are connected to each other and all living things. Those words that come before all else led us on a path of mutual respect and gratitude for our minds to become one. Through the inherent principles offered through such Haudenosaunee philosophy, my goal was to inspire everyone present to creatively envision a just society for an honorable future. The event took place on January 23, 2016 from 12 to 4 and was strategically located in the lobby of OCAD University for the reason to attract foot traffic from students and participants attending the Social Justice Exchange panels and workshops. The four-hour endurance public reading was enacted by multiple voices and featured 35 Indigenous and non-Indigenous OCADU students, staff, faculty, and community members across the GTA. Well Read was complemented with a hands-on reflective workshop facilitated by artist Lisa Myers, who shared berries with participants as an offering to nurture them as they read and listened to four rounds of 94 calls to action. The blueberries, a significant material to Lisa's work that represents her grandfather's experience of residential school, were eaten with small bird spoons, and each participant was invited to attach their spoon to a piece of fabric with a beaded thread. These spoons and the resulting document produced emphasize the presence and commitment to these recommendations we must undertake. The stained bowls holding the berries and reflections written on the ribbons were nailed to the wall and exhibited as an immediate testament in response to the community's actions. This was one example of how art and public engagement can galvanize our relationships with one another, with a goal to achieve social justice and change and make known whose art matters. So to end, I just want to go back to the test that I gave you at the beginning and emphasize that the Group of Seven, the Professional Indian Artists Inc., also known as Indian Group of Seven, and the Group of Seven, both movements have formed a national identity for Canada, and they both should find equal footing in art history classes. Thank you.